Hey, I'm Nate Flax.
I'm Noah Longworth McGuire.
And this is Talking Lion.
Talking Lion is a podcast focused on artist-to-artist conversation.
We're primarily artists, a duo called Sleeping Lion, but we've been lucky enough to write, produce, and hang out with so many incredible rising artists since we started our project.
Whether it's at sessions or parties or over cups of coffee, we've talked with our creative friends about everything. Music, life, love, and all the subtle complexities that come with being in the middle of a journey.
Talking Lion is about hitting record on these conversations and sharing them with you. There's no real structure, nothing really prepared, just friends talking about life and what it's been like and where it's going.
We now have a Patreon for fans of our show to help keep this going. Subscribers will become a part of the show in various ways, from providing questions to our guests, to getting a shout out on the show, to actually being on the show to chat with us. We'll even send you a mug.
So check out our Patreon at patreon.com/talkinglion.
We recorded this episode with our friend Tim from Vancouver Sleep Clinic.
We first met Tim in 2017 when we opened for Vancouver Sleep Clinic in Boston. We've remained friends since, and we've run into each other a couple times in Los Angeles.
Some context for this interview. We recorded this remotely towards the beginning of this year's quarantine. Tim had released an album titled Onwards to Zion a few months earlier.
An early influence for us and a supportive friend, Vancouver Sleep Clinic shaped the sonics of the current generation of pop while remaining true to his sound. So,
without further ado,
I'm Tim from Vancouver Sleep Clinic and this is Talking Lion.
Hey.
Hey, how's it going?
Good, good. How's everything been in this weird sort of apocalyptic time?
Yeah, it's been pretty strange. Kind of like, yeah, just trying to find different ways to like use time. There's like a lot of extra time now, obviously. So it's kind of like being like a bit of a curveball, I guess, for everyone. But it's kind of nice in a way. It gives you sort of some time to like chill out a bit and think about what I want to do next. And yes, it's kind of like a bit of a mixed emotional thing, I guess. It's kind of like,
You're back in Australia now?
Yeah, so I'm back in Australia. I was out in London, like kind of right before it all happened. And I was meant to be there another couple months and then it all kind of just went crazy. So had to get back home before they shut the border.
Yeah.
What was going on in London?
I was just working on new music. So I was just kind of like pretty much just starting like the new album process. And
oh, cool. So you're working with people on your records. Were you writing or producing on anybody else's records as well?
No, it's just my own stuff.
That's awesome.
So in London, I was just kind of working with a couple of producers, just trying to sort of find the right sort of collaborator to like get going with it. So yeah, it's one of those things like it kind of really makes you think about perspective a lot because like, and at least for me, like, you know, it's easy for me to get caught up about the situation and be like, oh, I had to go home and I had to blah, blah, blah. But like, I guess on the scale of things, like people are like losing their jobs and like they're, you know, struggling to pay rent and stuff. Like, so I guess like as far as like careers go or whatever, like, I mean, we can stay inside and make music, write, record and read, whatever. It's like, it's, you know, it's at the end of the world. So
and I know plenty of people like, who are sort of like policing themselves, like policing kind of how they should be feeling about this, like both on the negative and the positive. Like I know people are feeling really down and like, oh, well, I'm lucky. I shouldn't feel down. And also people who are enjoying this and they're like, well, this is a terrible thing. I shouldn't be enjoying this. I think the best thing to do is just not police any of it and just take it day by day and kind of enjoy what this could be, you know?
I saw something going around. I can't even remember what the quote was, but it's just something about like, it's okay to just survive, which I think is cool. Yeah. Because you can kind of, as a creative, you can kind of put all this pressure on yourself to like, you know, oh, I have all this time now. I have to accomplish this and I have to do this. And but, you know, in reality, it is pretty hard to like be inspired, especially right now. And it's like, maybe it's okay just to like chill out.
No, I agree. But I mean, not to mention like our sleep schedule is completely screwed up. I woke up at like 2 today. both AM and PM. So
time is just like completely irrelevant.
Yeah. Oh man.
The days are all just like blending together. It's wild. Yesterday I was going to like work and stuff and I played FIFA all day. And then I just like looked at the clock. It was like 2 a.m. I was like, oops.
We've been playing Overwatch like pretty hardcore.
Oh, nice.
So
yeah.
Do you play Overwatch?
I haven't played it, but I've heard lots of good things about it.
You know,
I'll probably get it.
I love that you're a FIFA player. I think every time I've played FIFA, my best friend loves playing FIFA. Just, I absolutely get wrecked. It's so, for some reason, it's such a hard game. I'm a game person, and that game for some reason is too vexing.
Yeah, FIFA's
for me.
Kind of its own beast, I feel.
Yeah, it is.
It's intersection completely different. Of like gaming and soccer.
Yeah, and I feel like it helps to understand soccer as well. Like, I feel like it doesn't, like sport games for some reason, it's like helpful to know how the sport, like to have played the sport.
Yeah, because definitely. You
can kind of know what. But yeah, it's just like, that's how I got into it. I was just getting pounded. Like I got smashed by all my friends. And then like, I was like, all right, it was like a challenge to my like manhood. I was
yeah.
Like, okay. Like I need to like stand my authority on these guys. So I practiced and got better.
You know, I, like my friend, it would be like this nice little ego sort of boost because
yeah,
he played exactly. He played actual sports, but like there were three of us and he was more sporty. And then me and my other friend were very nerdy. Like we're talking like Magic the Gathering, like League of Legends area of nerddom.
Yeah, yeah.
And so, you know, he would get beaten in like Smash Bros and like the more sort of quintessentially gaming games, but he would just clean the floor with us in FIFA.
That's me exactly. I'll get beaten in everything else. Like hands down, I'm terrible.
Maybe that'll be an inspiration for us to get better at the game. Just, you know, just eventually just so we don't get, but now we challenge you to play Overwatch so that you could join our
yeah,
team.
Yeah, we have to do like, I have to, it goes both ways, I guess.
Yeah. No, but it's nice to have you on. It's cool. Cause, and I was just sort of, I was thinking about this just like in preparation for it, that we first heard your music really like, in the first week of starting Sleeping Lion.
Oh, really?
We had just wow. gotten back to school. We were just starting to like put the finishing touches on like the last songs, and Discover Weekly had just come out.
Oh yeah.
And you were like, Collapse was like on the first Discover Weekly we ever had. So it was really nice and kind of full circle that one of the last shows we played in Boston was opening for you at Great Scott. Like that was such a fun, but also like yeah, full circle kind of night for us.
It feels like an eternity game now.
Yeah.
Seriously.
Nice. When was that? That was probably like 3 or 4 years ago, isn't it?
Yeah, I think it was 2017.
Yeah, I think so.
Why did I say 2017. It was 2017. Yeah.
It was so little. I actually saw that photo again like 6 months ago. Like,
yeah.
We were all like outside or something. I was like, man, we're so little.
Yeah, that was just such a fun show. And it was just so cool. I don't know, just to again, because I consider Collapse to be like one of the foundational kind of songs for when we started, because that was what was just in our ears. I mean, it was just cool to do that, you know. But you're also a fan of improv. We ran into you at improv a couple times.
Yeah.
Did you ever do like that kind of stuff growing up, like improv games or any of that?
I just did drama in high school.
Cool. Like, what, were you a theater kid?
No, I wasn't a theater kid. I was like dabbling in it. Like I kind of like, I just like drama because it's kind of a blow off. Like as far as like classes go, I love like watching it, and I love like I can really appreciate it, like stand up and improv and all that stuff. I love it, but.
I think we go every Thursday because I feel like, especially in what we do, it's like so important to kind of just get like a fix of laughter, you know, because I feel like sometimes we're writing sad songs or we're writing songs in a certain vibe, but, you know, we're not necessarily writing comedy.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Slash just like leave the house.
Yeah, that's. Remember when we used to be able to do that? Those were the days.
Those were the days. Back yeah. in 2017.
When you could leave the house.
Jeez. Too soon, bro.
The before times. No, but that's awesome, though. Noah and I are both recovered theater kids. We did
tons of drama.
Like drama club. My mom was actually the drama club teacher at my school. So she would be like doing all the after school improv classes.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
My dad was my business teacher, so I know how you feel.
Oh, wow. Oh, man. That's definitely, that's high pressure.
So you guys haven't done theater since the Sleeping Lion stuff or what?
Not really. I mean, I stopped doing theater in high school. I didn't really go down that route in college.
Yeah.
But there's still a part of me that's, especially since moving to Los Angeles, there's definitely still a part of me. It's like one of these days, I'm just going to snap and do a community theater production of like Tennessee Williams or something. Like I'm about one day away from that on any given week.
I was just going to say, I remember you having like a crazy like musicality there. Like I remember just watching you play, I was like, damn, that's not fair.
Well, Noah's a crazy multi-instrumentalist. I mean,
that's also just what going to music school does to you.
Yeah, right. So that's like, you kind of like geeked out at music school.
Yeah, I got to go full music geek at Berkeley and get that shit out of my system. Yeah,
I mean, you guys are obviously both great musicians.
No, I appreciate it. I think actually where we work together really well is that we both can play the same instruments, but Noah plays them better. And so he's able to get some of the cool like technical stuff, but then like I'll come in with like some voicings or some simplicity or whatever that like balances out.
You can kind of like, you can kind of like tame him a bit.
Yeah, but if anything, my curse is always doing too much musically.
So I
need people to rein me in all the time.
Yeah, cool.
But that's on that note, I mean, I'm still really like into film stuff. Like I still do sound design stuff. I love TV and movies like nobody's business. And actually, like I signed up for a UCB class to do like to do improv. And my first class was like right, like it was supposed to be in April. It was right as all this was starting. Right. So they canceled the first class and moved it all to July.
Damn.
So I was going to take an improv class, but and that was like that's a big New Year's resolution, but it's going to happen later on
this
year.
All of our New Year's resolutions got postponed.
Postponed our New Year's resolutions.
They're all 2021.
You think there's going to be like a new year? Like after coronavirus,
The
quarantine ends, like everyone's going to take it as like the beginning of a new kind of
year. Yeah, we just change everything. Resolutions.
New year?
New year.
Second New Year.
Christmas
second
is like year. August, like 6.
You grew up in Australia, yeah?
Yeah.
What area?
So I'm from Brisbane.
Oh, cool.
Okay.
Which I've been like here my whole life pretty much.
What was that experience like? Were you in sort of musical communities as a kid? Like how did you sort of first get bitten by this bug?
So I was actually like I played heaps of sport as a kid. That was like my main thing. And like until I was like 15, I wanted to be, do you know what the sport cricket is?
Yeah.
I wanted to be a cricket player for Australia. So I was like, spent all my time doing that. I didn't even really, like I listened to music, I listened to my dad's stuff, my dad's records, but like I didn't really like, I wasn't playing it that much or anything.
Was your dad an artist?
He's just like a guitar, he just like, he has like 6 or 7 guitars, he just loves playing it. He's just like, just for fun.
Nice.
But yeah, so I was like, I mean, I've dabbled around on stuff, like I had a drum kit as my first instrument, but I was playing cricket like every weekend, like every day, and then I got injured when I was like 15, got a real bad injury, and then when that happened, I had all of a sudden I had all this spare time, and I was like, and that was the other thing is like sport was like my social. I was like, I mean, that's how I hung out with all my friends. I couldn't do that anymore. So my new thing became like being in bands and like, you know how cool that like social thing is, like when you're in a band with all your friends and you just kind of like after school, you just like dicking around in your instruments and play some friend's party and you're like the cool, you feel like the coolest kids. In it's like that whole thing. That's kind of what got me into it. It was like the social thing and just having fun with friends and just like naturally kind of, I could never became a point where I was like, oh, I want to do this as a career or I want to like, you know, I want to make a ton of money doing it. It's just kind of, like, I like playing with my friends. And then people eventually liked what we were doing. There's a lot of crappy bands.
What was the name of your high school band? Because I love high school band names.
Oh, it's so bad. So my first band is called Summertime Static.
Was this before or after Lana Del Rey had the song?
Oh, that was Summertime Sadness. This is before that.
But you were ahead of the time. You were ahead of your time.
But it was like, it was so bad. It was like obviously like pop punk or whatever.
Yeah. Oh yeah. I mean, of course.
Like,
of course.
We did photo shoots down in the park.
I think I actually had a train track photo. It's there somewhere, you know?
That's classic.
My band was called Fall From Earth, and then it was The First Law.
Oh, that's not too bad.
You know, I feel like Fall From Earth is a little bit on the cringier side. I feel like The First Law, I still...
Yeah,
The
First Law is solid. Oh, man, I had some bad band names. My pop punk band went through so many iterations. At one point, it was... Tempest 242, which oof.
Tempest 242.
It was also Best and a Whale. It came from an inside joke, and it was just like a new metal band. And then it was Pure Mindless Vandalism.
I like Pure Mindless Vandalism.
Pure Mindless Vandalism is a solid pop punk band name, but it took a while to get there. It was iteration 3.
That's so funny. Hey, you wouldn't trade that for the world, though.
No, yeah, it's a experience.
Do you ever listen back to the, like, I feel like whenever I get a little bit jaded by all of this stuff, I listen back to like the First Law records to be like, oh yeah, like that, on the one hand, that's what it felt like to make music without any kind of like pressure or sort of external, you know, thing. Yeah. But on the other hand, like, it's nice not to like suck like that anymore, you know?
Yeah. I definitely like listen back for the nostalgia and then I stop after 30 seconds because I'm like cringing so hard.
Yeah. Yeah. When did you sort of stop going in the pop punk direction and sort of move towards, because at first it was sort of like the vibey minimalism aspect? Like, when did that kind of...
Yeah.
And were you always singing in that kind of falsetto space too? Or did you kind of discover that as well?
No, it's a pretty funny, story. So I was like doing, I was obviously just doing pop punk, like listening to like Linkin Park, Blink 182, Sum 41, System of a Down, all that stuff. I was like loving it. And then I kind of got, some of my friends started getting into indie music. We have this like radio station called Triple J out here.
Oh yeah.
Who are like, they play a bunch of alternative stuff, a lot of Australian stuff. And I kind of like prided myself on being like a bit of a hipster and like hard. It's super regrettable, but I was just like so try hard. So I would be like, I would make it my like personal like mission to like find all of these like super hipster bands that no one knew about and be like, how do you not know these guys? They're so good. You know, just like that classic, like.
No, listen, I'm from New York, so I completely get the, if anything, the hipster, I saw the hipster boom and burst of the other thing. And and also like when we started, we were really jealous of Australian artists as a general concept because of Triple J. You guys had such an awesome, like centralized way of discovering and supporting awesome new artists. We don't really have that here. I mean, now we have Spotify, so
So I was getting into all that. Like I did a real hard flip. Like I was almost like trying to compromise for all my, I was like, man, how did I listen to that stuff before? Like indie music is so cool. And then I remember the band I first heard that made me like really feel emotional power of music was Sigur Rós.
Oh,
I
remember
like hearing them. And I was like, man, they don't even sing in English, but I like feel something when I listen to them. And that was kind of the moment where I was like, man, this is like, because before I was just like, I'd just write for fun or I would write, I wouldn't even, like I'd write stories maybe about other people, just like narratives or whatever. Because I used to like writing novels and stuff. So I just used to use that. And then I was like, when I heard Sigur Rós, I was like, man, I can actually put my feelings into the song and like have it translate across to other people in different areas of life. Because it's like that universal power music is awesome. So that's kind of what started getting me into that like more emotionally invested direction. And then the falsetto thing, that happened literally just because I started it when I was going through voice break. So I was like, I couldn't sing in my chest voice all the time because my voice would keep like leaping up. So I was like, I just wrote one song, the first song called Vapor. And I sung it all in falsetto because I wasn't like confident in my chest voice. And I kind of just got locked into that because that was the song that sort of started taking off. So, and people were like, his voice is cool. So I was like, okay, maybe I just like go with that then. Like it wasn't a conscious like thing. I was like, all right, let's just go falsetto. It's like.
when you say yeah. it took off, was that in like the SoundCloud world, the Spotify world, Triple J or some combination of all of them?
It was SoundCloud and then also Triple J. I was a finalist. They have this competition called Unearthed High, which is where they go pick all these high school bands and like play them on the radio, like on rotation. So I got played heaps. They played me heaps on radio and stuff. So that really helped.
That's awesome.
SoundCloud Hype Machine, all that stuff. Yeah.
I mean, those were the days. Like that was.
Those were the days, man.
I think we hit the Hype Machine thing just like a year or two too late, like right as the end of the wave. But even just like the little push, you know, let us do this thing for the last, you know, 5 years or whatever. The sort of people who came a bit before us, like you guys and like, you know, even like Halsey or whatever, like Hype Machine thing was like the whole, you know, that was the start of all that stuff.
I mean, even Post Malone. I think Post Malone's first song was like SoundCloud.
Yeah. Now, like I said, like the song that sort of put sonically introduced, you know, us to you was Collapse. I'm like really curious how that song started and came to be and then what sort of unlocked that song for you.
So that song was actually, it came from math class. I was like super bored. I read in my math book, at least like the hook. I remember writing the hook in my math book. And yeah, it was just like, I mean, the song is like, it's just about like high school. I mean, and feeling like overwhelmed by everything. It's just like that classic teenage angst kind of thing.
There's a line like, I've been outgrown, right?
Yeah. Just kind of like, you know, I mean, not for everyone, but for me, at least in high school, it was just like a lot. And it just felt like, I mean, it collapsed, and most of that, all that whole EP was just like kind of me venting, like how much I wasn't really into school or the whole social games and all that stuff, like just in my own way, it's obviously more metaphorical and more, especially because I wasn't like really that vulnerable at that point. So that's something you kind of learn as a writer, I guess, is like how to be more vulnerable and say things. But I would just like kind of like use a lot of imagery and like stuff to kind of conceal or like kind of paint the picture, I guess. But yeah, and that's how the song happened, is just in math. And then I had a friend and I paid him like $500 to like produce the whole EP, which is hilarious because at the time that was a lot of money for me. Yeah. I didn't have a job and I was like busking. So I saved up for a few, like a month to pay for it. But then like he got ripped off in the end because he didn't get a cut on it and it did. So
he didn't get points.
Damn, it's to work for hire.
Nah, it was before any of that. It was just like for fun, you know. Like I didn't even know what I was doing. I was just like, it'd be fun to like do this EP.
You can take him out for dinner now, though. You know.
Yeah, do you still keep in touch?
Oh, you can take him out for dinner now. You know, take him out for a nice dinner.
Actually, I haven't seen him in a few years, but yeah, he was awesome. Like, he really helped me get going with everything. Yeah, appreciate it.
I think what was so interesting about Collapse, not like, because in my head it was like two things at the same time. Like the first was on the kind of marketing side of it. It was the first time I'd seen Discover Weekly. Like it was the first song I discovered on Discover Weekly, which is now that Discover Weekly has been out for 5 years or whatever.
This is on Spotify, right? You're talking about?
Yeah. But when they had just sort of, you know, which obviously that's different for everybody, but it was like algorithmically they thought I would like you and they were right. I think it showed up on Noah's too.
Yeah.
And I remember, it's funny, like I sent like my ex-girlfriend the songs. I'm like, I found this song. You should, I think you'd like it. But and the week after that, we got Girls Your Age by Transviolet, who was also somebody who's been on the show. So it's just funny how like that era of Discover Weekly was just like pushing these like really cool, yet like budding independent artists.
Yeah.
I'm so old school that we didn't have it on Spotify for like a year. And then we had to upload it. Like we're like, oh, Spotify's a thing now. Like because we'd already put the EP out on SoundCloud and stuff and iTunes. And then, then it was like a year later, it's like, wait a minute.
Oh, wow.
It should be on Spotify.
So it says it came out like in 2013, but it was really out like in 2012.
Oh no, dude, 2016. Yeah, it's 2016 on Spotify. Wow.
That tracks. Jeez. Like that tracks for at least where we were at.
Jeez. We missed like 2 years of streaming. That's so funny. Yeah, I did it in 2014, started 2014.
But you were getting the Triple J buzz at that point already, right?
Yeah, that was like 2013. SoundCloud Triple J was like happening. And then 3 years later, Spotify.
I hate asking this question on the show, but I have to ask for you specifically, how did you come up with the name?
Oh, yeah. I don't know. I just always kind of wanted something that was going to be interesting and like something that you could remember and like Google. And I felt like it sort of painted the picture of like kind of just like a therapeutic sort of like sound. And like, I don't know, Vancouver, the city is super like rainy and mountains. And
I love Vancouver.
It just all kind of felt right. Like I played around with like a lot of ideas and I was like, this is cool. This is different.
Yeah. It's a very aesthetic name. It's just got an inherent kind of aesthetic quality to it, which I think matches.
I was
up
just
well
like, I was,
you sound like,
yeah, I was just like happy to roll with. And as I said, like the thing, I didn't even put a lot of thought into anything at all. Like I just kind of did it. And at the time I was in another band and stuff. So this was just kind of like on the side. I literally remember just like typing the name out. I got my sister to take a photo of me against the curtain in the house.
the white photo?
Oh, it's so bad. Yeah. it's actually terrifying. Like it's like I've done all I can to get it off the internet, but it's still there. But yeah, it was just like that. It was that like effortless. It was just like it just happened. So that same with the name. I don't really overthink it a lot.
Was she involved with the first record at all? Like musically?
My sister?
Yeah.
No.
I don't know why for some reason.
She can sing. She's like an amazing. She actually is the theater kid. She does a lot of theater.
She's one of us.
But, one of us.
Yeah, one of you guys. She's crazy.
Well, I'm I love the name. Obviously, we're partial to sleep related names. I think when we played the show, we joked around about like Vancouver Sleeping Lion Clinic.
Yeah, definitely. it was meant to be Sleep Fest.
Yeah, the next like song that like, well, I remember hearing it live and just absolutely getting floored by it. But Killing Me to Love You is just such a intense song off of Revival. Like what yeah. was this like, wait, how did you kind of crack that song? Like what sort of unlocked that one for you?
So the Revival album was like the first project I did with like, well, I did the whole thing with this guy called Al Shocks, and it was the first time I had like proper, I guess, any sort of money and like any like kind of resources and time. So Killing Me, it was the first song we recorded for the album, and it actually happened really quickly because I just remember that feeling of like how cool it was that it didn't have to be just me like working on a song. I remember like being with this guy, he was like probably 30 at the time. I was like, man, this guy is like such a, he could do everything better than I could by like five times better. And I was just like, I remember just watching him. I was like, man. And then he did all his thing, and then I did my vocals. And it's just like, so like, I still remember, I was like 18 at the time. I was like, man, you know, that super rare feeling when you like, I don't know, you just like know that you're doing, you actually like have full confirmation in what you're doing. You're like, man, this is unreal. Like the euphoria is crazy. And you're like, it doesn't happen often as an artist. Like a lot of the time you kind of like, at least for me, like, you know, you doubt yourself, you second guess yourself, what you're doing and like your whole life. And then, but working on that song, like before we kind of got stuck into the album, it all came together. I was like, man, this is easy. This is awesome.
I feel like I chased that high all that time, all the time. Like, I feel like I chased that feeling of like, oh, we just like, we just got this. Like we just sort of.
Yeah, exactly.
Dialed it in, you know?
That was like the one of the rare times. I still always remember it. Just that first day in the studio and that song happened. I was like, man, we can do this whole album that easy. And then the album took like 2 years.
Yeah.
was there a moment like a lyric or like or a sort of feeling in the song, like one specific part of the song that really like turned up that, you know, dopamine spike?
You know, it was the drums. That when you started programming the drums, because we kind of had this like this piano refrain, I was kind of singing this "Kill Me, I Love You," that was kind of happening. It was all like, you know, nice and pretty and emotional. And then he chopped up this drum loop and like played it in, and you know, the Winter EP is just super like chill and like mostly just like 808 type drums and like very like basic. And then this guy came in like with a full on beat. And I just remember being in the studio. I was like, man, I can make music that's like dreamy and like got like some like punch to it. And it's like a cool energy, because I hadn't had that kind of energy in my music before. It felt like a step up.
Well, and that's like why I mentioned, you know, when we saw it live, like yeah. I'd heard the record. I loved the record, but just hearing it live, I think almost breathed a different kind of life into it. Cause you feel that whole sort of like you feel the dynamics, you feel the wall of sound just kind of like,
yeah. Especially like, with the live drums.
Oh yeah.
Or just being like, yeah, really cool.
That's kind of, that's what like, see, I don't know what it's like for you guys, but for me, playing live is like my favorite part of music thing. That's kind of what I think about when I make music. I'm not a big indoors person, so when I'm in the studio, I'm generally like projecting like what it would look like and how it would sound like on a stage.
I feel like we have a love-hate relationship with playing live, and I want you to comment on it too. When we start Sleeping Lion, we did not want to play live at all. We actually kind of wanted to be anonymous.
Oh,
and then
really?
We were sort of like, yeah, oh. I mean, it just, I think we just wanted to like see how the music would do without trying to like worry about how it would adapt in a live setting. Like,
I think we were just starting to make electronic music. So I think our focus was like, can we make a record that sounds cool and not worry about like, cause we were also in music school. So there was so much emphasis for us on like playing our instruments that part of it was just an escape from like that, like hard and fast, like getting into a practice room and like getting a show together.
But it was also just like, yeah, we didn't want to like get a band or whatever, because at school it was just so hard to kind of get all of that together, despite being surrounded by great musicians, just getting, locking down the practice. We started Sleeping Lion as a duo because we were tired of trying to figure out the practice room situation just to make music. We could just work out of our room and do this. But it was also just that, like, when we started, we were broke as hell. And so a lot of our setup, like the SPD and like everything, was very utilitarian. Like, it was specifically like, what can we fit in an Uber pool? To get to the thing. And we never really evolved from there, because we always, like, whenever we would get shows or like whenever it would be this thing, we just never had the resources to like really get like a proper playback rig, or to like get, you know, get a drummer. Even getting another member would require us to like get a playback rig because of how our setup was. It was basically an idea of kind of resources. And it was, I will tell you, the best part in Boston was when we could open for bands that we loved. Like when we would open, when we opened for you in Boston, that was like really awesome for us. And we loved when we could, like, you know, Brass Tracks too. Like we loved when we could like open for like acts that had really great crowds, and the, you know, we could meet, you know, people and sort of be on the stage with them. But we also played a bunch of shit shows. And I think we were just kind of starting to get into like getting a drummer and get like redoing some of our live tracks and also writing songs kind of around playing them live better. But then all this happened. So we're putting a little bit break.
I saw you guys play
a break on that.
I saw you guys play. I can't remember how long it was now. Probably 2 years ago. Was it Peppermint Club? It was somewhere.
Yeah, you came to the Peppermint Club show.
Is that the Transviolet show?
I'm surprised I remember that. Yeah, that was a sick show. I remember that being awesome. But
that meant the world to me that you came. In Los Angeles, people say they'll come to shows and then some traffic and whatever, and it just meant a lot that you.
Classic, hey, just LA. It's just LA stuff. You just get used to.
That was an important show for us because we met Transviolet opening for them and then wound up writing a song. That was how we met them, and then we wound up writing a song with them.
Yeah,
like, they were playing at that show.
Yeah, we were opening for them, I think.
Oh, cool. Yeah, sick.
But yeah,
that was probably a while ago now. Damn, it's gone so fast.
Yeah,
that was two and a half years.
Have you guys been doing shows recently?
Not really. Done a couple acoustic shows, but nothing like.
Yeah. We had just kind of taken on a drummer as all this was starting up. So
And
then our drummer broke his heels.
So we had to put that kind of on hold. And then all the coronavirus stuff started.
Damn.
Yeah.
That's hectic.
No, but yeah. Live is so interesting though, because I do feel like when you get to see a band live, you can create new relationships with certain songs. Like I know certain songs that like maybe I was, you know, I didn't really necessarily, you know, obsess over on a record, but then I can hear the thing that you can love about it when you play it live, and then go back to the record and glean that and remember that and kind of reconnect to a song.
Definitely.
What's your favorite song to play live?
Personally, I really like playing Ayahuasca just because it's long and I can kind of just like trip out and like kind of just so that's kind of the moment where I can really soak it in, because there's a lot of like instrumental stuff and it's just like, but then like also Someone This Day is like the one everyone sings to, so that's like it's a nice moment, I guess, to like, that's kind of like to see that people kind of appreciate what you do.
It's funny because awesome, I was gonna ask about those two songs specifically. So I guess staying on Revival, what sort of was the inspiration for Someone to Stay? Because that song is like the, I was looking today, like that's the song that I think everybody's been, a lot of people have been introduced to you with.
And it's so weird because it didn't, when it came out, the song didn't get playlisted once on Spotify. Like no one put it anywhere. And then like, it didn't really do much for ages. And then like, it got put in a couple movies and TV shows. And then just
which movies?
Like, it's like, it got put in this movie Before We Go, which is like a Chris Evans one. And it got put in all these like Teen Wolf, I think.
Oh yeah.
Well, you see it with Ash, like, you know, Moral of the Story came out last year and did all right, and then all of a sudden it was in that Netflix movie, like the sequel to all the Boys I Loved Before, and became like, you know, radio top 40, you know.
It's amazing.
In a week.
Yeah, it's so weird. Like, it's, I remember also seeing it with there was a song, do you know Lord Huron?
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
I don't know if I'm saying that right. That song, The Night We Met,
that was in 13 Reasons Why.
It got put on whatever that show was.
Yeah.
And then, it got like, and the song had been out for like 7 years.
Yeah.
Also, I feel like
so amazing.
Just so many songs on like Riverdale.
These teenage girl type shows, and they're all like at home crying, and then they hear a nice emotional song and they're like, Shazam, like, what is it?
No, I mean, I personally discovered so much music from Grey's Anatomy and like
Scrubs
and like the Twilight soundtrack. The first Twilight soundtrack had insane music on it. So like,
that is
a great place to find new music.
Dude, Paramore?
Yeah, Decode. Decode is a sick song.
Oh my God,
Decode,
that's like an so insane.
And Mute Math had Spotlight on the
Twilight
soundtrack.
Spotlight was on Mute Math?
That's how I discovered Mute Math, was the Twilight soundtrack.
Also, Iron and Wine was on that record.
Yeah. Whew. So many good bands on that record.
Yeah. Some of these like shows just have like a real good taste for it. And like, I know people that just like half the reason they watch these shows is because the music's cool.
Yeah.
They're, like finding music on it.
Yeah. With like the, you know, like the OC and Scrubs and Grey's Anatomy, like those, like I've read in like music business books, whatever, it was like those music supervisors like changed the music supervision game and like kind of like yeah. opened the door to independent artists.
Yeah. It's like, awesome. Hey, they like, yeah.
But it's, I mean, it's really awesome like that song like popped off. What was the sort of inspiration for it?
I did like a mission trip to Cambodia, like kind of,
wow,
like just after I started the album. And yeah, I kind of just got like smacked in the face by like, just, I don't know, the fact that like myself and like, I guess a lot of us can sort of just forget about a lot of the things going on in the world. Like I hadn't even thought about anything outside of my own little bubble. And I kind of saw that. And then you just feel like real powerless. Like just seeing like the poverty and like this and that. And then like, interestingly, like, cause I was doing that album in downtown LA, just like I went back there to do it and I was feeling really inspired. And then you see like even on Skid Row and like just, I mean, everywhere in Hollywood, just like it's insane because of how like prosperous the city is and how many rich people there are. And you see that kind of diversity. And me just as like a small time, like Australian kind of indie artist, I was like, what can I actually do to like, I mean, I felt like so helpless, but that was kind of like what I channeled into the song. Just sort of that feeling of like, doesn't matter what city you're in or like what kind of climate or anything, like there's just people everywhere that are just forgotten about. And, you know, so that's kind of where the original thing came from.
Was there a line that started it?
Oh, it's probably the wheel needs someone to stay. That was probably the first lyric. I can't really remember, to be honest, but I'm sure that was like towards the start.
Well, I think the other thing that I love about the Revival record is the art. Like I remember when the art really cool. first came out. Hell, I would have gotten a shirt. I think I was so broke I couldn't even get a shirt. But I loved the the art that I got a poster though. I remember I have the poster still.
Oh, sick.
Because the art for that record was so cool. Who did it? And then like what inspired you? Because there's something macabre yet like organically beautiful about it.
Yeah, I can't really take any credit for it. I mean, there's this guy called Pandagunda and I got hooked up with him. We jumped on a call and I talked about what the album was to me and he kind of listened to it and spent a lot of time and he kind of came across with the idea of like playing with the anatomy. I mean, I love nature and I love like natural feeling things. And I really like, yeah, it's something I really like. Just, I also really like the idea of a whole album just being conceptually like nice to look at. Like I really like, one of the things I said to him was like, I'd really like to have all of the art like next to each other on my wall and it would look really nice together. So it was cool that he was able to find a concept and like piece it all together, like using different parts of the body and different like beautiful natural elements kind of flourishing out of that. Kind of fit the name Revival as well really nicely, I felt, because it felt like the idea of taking like a, you know, parts of your body that are just wiltering away, like your bones, and like bringing life and some sort of like external like nourishment to that. I thought that was pretty cool.
Well, that resonates with us. I love what you say about hanging on your wall, because like that has always been kind of, when it comes to like cover art, where our brains go is like kind of thinking of it like from a film perspective sometimes, of like, oh, you could watch five movies by a director and know like that's their movie if they're like a good director. And that always was like, I want you to look at this like cover art and look at like three different cover arts and know that they're all, you know, our songs. And that's, I feel like Revival was just like, it perfectly like captured what each song was about, but also was such a unique piece of art as well, especially at a time like, you know, around the Hype Machine time, around all that, where we were seeing kind of a lot of the same kind of art around it. So I remember just like snapping. That's awesome. I think I snatched up the poster and then like had everybody in the band sign it.
Oh, that's awesome. I'm glad that it all worked.
Yeah.
It's definitely what I was trying to do. It's definitely interesting now as well, because I mean, especially in like the current music climate, like it's not really, I mean, it's more for the artists, for yourself that you do that stuff, because, you know, it's not as important to fans or people anymore, like putting together like four videos that all work together, or four pieces of artwork that people just want to hear, like, music and, like, a lot of it. And, like, you have to kind of keep pumping it out. That's the idea. But, like, it's really just for, like, you as artists, like, to, like, at least for me, when I, because I still like thinking of things as a concept and putting things together as a concept. But in reality, like, people don't really care as much about that now, because, you know, I mean, people aren't even really buying records as much. I mean, there's always going to be hipsters buying vinyl, but, like, you know, like, back, you know, 10 years ago when you buy the CD and you get the booklet and you're looking through the booklet and everything's so cool, like, you know, or you get all the merch. So, yeah, I remember even going to, like, my local CD shop, and you get, like, bands would print these, like, boxes where they have the CD and they'd have, like, a shirt and they'd have all this, like, all, like, a double CD. There's all this stuff, packaging and everything.
You can win a Grammy for the packaging. But, you know, there's literally, like, a Grammy award for, like, best packaging of a record. Like, you know, best...
Like,
still, yeah,
that's awesome. I didn't know that,
but yeah, that's like, that's I totally feel that. I remember getting the Phrase record and just, yeah, like,
I love that,
parsing through, like, you know, mind you, it came with a download code to get it on iTunes as well,
yeah.
But like, I just would parse through that record. I love ayahuasca, and people are gonna just snip that, like, out of context, just be like, I love doing ayahuasca, yeah,
I can tell, bro.
Yeah, right. Hey, you know, we take
drugs.
Yeah, we're psychedelic enthusiasts on the show. We're pretty open about LSD and stuff. Never done ayahuasca though. We talked to Axel, who's talking about an ayahuasca trip before. But it's an 8-minute piece of music, and I love just how it flows and how it, like, it goes from these sort of these sections almost with, like, repeating elements and whatnot. What I'm going to ask, like, was it inspired by an ayahuasca trip, and how did that song kind of come to be, and what kind of made you decide to do an 8-minute piece of music in, you know, the late 2010s?
So, I mean, firstly, I haven't done ayahuasca, which is pretty funny, but basically how it happened, I was kind of like a few months after moving to LA, and I was just like, I don't know. I'm not really that into the vibe. I mean, some people are. Some people are, like, born for it, like, the hustle, and, like, they love all that stuff. But I come from kind of just, like, busking, like I said, playing music with my friends. And LA is very, like, everyone's just about business and about whatever. So I'd done a bunch of sessions and all that stuff, and I was working on different songs. And I was like, man, I'm just so fed up with it. Like, I just kind of hit this point. I was like, I'm fed up with it. I'm just going to, like, lock myself in my studio apartment for, like, a weekend and just make something that I want to do. Because, you know, like, I was just so sick of going into the studios and everyone's like, we need this hook to be more like this, and we need this verse to be shorter, and, like, rhyme this with this, like, whatever, like, all that stuff. I'm just not into it. So I was just like, I lock myself in the apartment. Yeah, I just, like, kind of went on a wild ride. And so the song's called Ayahuasca because I was watching all these YouTube documentaries about it, and I kind of went down the rabbit hole on it because I found it so interesting. And I ended up sampling this woman from a ceremony. She's like singing the da na 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 na, she's like doing that. So I kind of chopped that up, and I started playing guitar, and that's how the idea started. But I also felt like it fit this song because, you know, it felt like, at least for me, it was this kind of this wild ride of, like, spiritual discovery about myself, about being in this city that I wasn't really into, and, like, all of these different, you know, there's so many extreme highs and lows in LA, like, there's so much opportunity, but at the same time you can just get crushed, and it's kind of just about that whole, like, ride. And yeah, that's sort of how it happened.
I feel like Los Angeles is one of those cities where, like, you can build better than anywhere, you know, in the world, but that also applies a lot of pressure to your foundation. Like, yeah, whereas I feel like in other places, like, your foundation, like, who you are as a person and how you handle kind of stress and pressure and social situations and art are not necessarily kind of challenged on a daily basis, but also you're not necessarily growing in this oftentimes meteoric kind of way that you can in LA. So I feel like, you know, you take the good with the bad, and
it's a great way of looking at it. It's awesome.
Definitely. I think it hit me, you know, moving here. I don't think I ever got to the real, like, heartbreaking, burnt out point but mostly it was because I was talking to everybody who was there.
Yeah, I've heard so many cautionary tales from people who'd be like, yeah, I burnt out so bad. I slept for 18 months. The city crushed me. Like, I think I heard enough horror stories that I've managed to sort of keep my head on straight. But
well, it helps that you guys move together as well. I think that's important. Yeah. Like, you have people from your hometown or just like friends around that aren't from LA.
Well, and that's, you know, it was nice to like have some film friends out here so I could like, you know, flex that part of my brain. And I have some family out here too. But we moved out here and then Noah actually went back to Berkeley to finish up school.
Oh, okay.
Which I almost think was great because we got to do the first couple months together and just like get all that, like
get the shock,
be
the
together shock for the shock.
Yeah.
But then we had a second to like be like figure out who we were alone, like apart from each other. Cause at that point we had been friends and roommates for 4 years. So we hadn't really had a lot of space alone. We got to develop who we were sort of individually. And then we spent the last like 2 years just sort of figuring out, okay, well, who are these two individuals and how do they come together?
Yeah, yeah.
As opposed to we are roommates and we're starting this project and we are a unit.
All we
and
have.
This is all we have. And all we have is each other and like all this stuff, you know?
Nah, it's cool.
But I don't know. I love that ayahuasca is an experience. Like, and I think, just sort of knowing you too is like, I think anybody in LA would call a song longer than 4 minutes, you know, brave, whatever. I think for you, it's just expression. For you, it's like, this is something that you can sort of breathe through and like let it sort of wash over you.
Yeah.
And think if anybody, you know, could pull it off and anybody did pull it off, it's you. You know?
Oh, that's awesome. I'm glad. Yeah. It was kind of, you know, I just hit that point. I was like, I don't even care anyway. Like, I think that's the most important part is like, I was just caring so much before that. Everything I was doing, I was like, man, is the beat like go hard? Like, is like the hook catchy? Like, and I just kind of hit that point and it all came out. I was like, man, I could, like, I'm just going to make something. I don't even care. Like what anyone thinks about it. I don't care if it gets playlisted. I'm just going to do it and put it out. Cause that's like, I really like that sort of analogy you were using before about like LA, like you have this, like you kind of like, you can build a lot, you can get super high up and you kind of like forget where your foundation is.
Yeah.
That's how I felt. Like I kind of came out there and I, you know, just as like a kid, like busking on the streets, like jamming with my friends, like that's having fun with it. And then you come out there and I got somewhere and I like made some songs that did well and got money and stuff like that. And then I just remember looking at myself and I was like, man, what am I doing? Like, I don't even enjoy making this music. I don't enjoy being in these studios with people I've never met before. Like, it's just like, where's my foundation? Like, why am I doing what I'm doing? It doesn't make any sense.
Well, and it's funny, you know, that likewise, when I first moved here, I think I was trying to kind of like, I considered my kind of like superpower in this, the ability to kind of just like be aware of everything that was going on around me, like being aware of what everybody was doing. And I had a friend, I had two friends. One was an A&R who I was sort of like, kind of like dropping like, so-and-so is doing this and the so-and-so is doing this and how could we do this with so-and-so and so.
He's
like, Nate, if you are trying to keep your finger on the pulse of Los Angeles, you are going to lose your fucking mind. He was very honest with me. He's like, I'm really impressed, but you're gonna kill yourself. and then the other one was he was like a seasoned composer, like a veteran, like TV composer. I was telling him that, like, you know, I was seeing friends doing really well and like worried about the sort of trajectory of our own career and like not being productive enough or whatever. And he was like, Nate, like every day, just focus on the brick. Like every day, just lay one brick.
One brick.
You know, like don't worry about everybody else's house. Like just focus on your brick and eventually you'll have a house too. Like just focus on, did you lay that brick today? Which is how I'm, you know, going through this quarantine sort of thing too.
On that brick thing, like, I remember that's like, because I never really had issues with anxiety or anything like that, but I definitely like started getting like super overwhelmed while I was out in LA. And like, I remember that was like kind of a thing because I, you know, you're constantly just thinking about the whole house. You're like, man, like everyone else is building faster than I am. Like, how do I catch up? Like, how do I, you know, it just, you make the thing so much bigger than it is. And I remember the minute I started thinking, man, like, how do I just attack this day? And like, how do I just attack this song or this like chorus or this verse? It just makes it so much like easier in your mind. Like when you just break it down and you're like, it's obviously like it's a constant battle. You have to keep shutting out like all of the big like pressing like I mean, especially now, like, well, what's happening in the next 3 months? Like, what am I going to do? Like, for if I can just sit down in the morning, get coffee and be like, all right, today I'm just going to like try and like learn these scales, or I'm going to try and like write this like chorus. And that's what I want to do today. That's really helped me a lot. Just like, get.
Well, and you've been like, as you know, as Tim putting out like these hymns, which you were saying before we started recording, that's like sort of your place outside of this. Like, this is like,
yeah,
just like a sort of,
I'm trying to still like hone in on my craft and like learn more and do more, but I'm trying to like space out on the Vancouver stuff just for like at least a month or so, just so I can kind of get some fresh inspiration, try a few different things. And then that way, like when I'm ready to go back in album mode, like I'm going to be staying fresh, because I'm just trying not to really burn out too much. It's really like hard to find inspiration at the moment, or like just things to write about when you're not even like leaving the house. So I'm like, I'm just going to like, you know, I'm just going to play around with some stuff, like whatever. And then like, I'll be ready to go when this is done.
Yeah, we've been dealing with it by going back to old songs.
Yeah, which
like,
is great.
Like I was
too.
Saying, it's, you know, awesome. Just sort of like realizing that, like, oh, we didn't have the tools. Even like yesterday, we had a chorus that had been sitting around for 3 years.
Oh, wow.
That we had just we just weren't able to write around it. And then we were like, okay, well, now we have a writer who has always been able to bring out, you know, some of the stronger stuff in us. And we have all grown up like as writers in the last, you know, 3 years. And we knocked out the song in like an hour and a half, like the whole.
That's amazing. You know, whole. Wait, song, so you guys are working with a writer as well? Is that what you're saying?
We've been doing like a FaceTime session. Nice. Yeah. But we, for like the first 2 years of Sleeping Lion, or like before moving to Los Angeles, we did not let anybody into this.
Yeah.
And then our biggest song, I wound up co-writing it with my ex-girlfriend.
Oh,
and where that was like obviously a complicated situation, there was the kind of realization like, oh, we wrote a great song when it wasn't just Noah and I doing 100% of the stuff, because we could have somebody else balancing out or like just even challenging us to do better. And so now we've actually like been working with the same writer and occasionally the same kind of like finishing producer to just get that last, you know, to just inspire us,
amazing,
like get us out of our own sort
amazing
of ruts, you know?
Yeah, it helps a lot. Hey, when you like open up to the idea of, oh, I was the same. I was just like so egotistic. I was like, man, like only I know what I'm feeling. No one's gonna touch. And then like when you realize like, man, actually this person can play guitar better than I can. This person can do beats better than I can. Like this person, it's like, man, why wouldn't I want to get other people to help out?
Well, and not to keep slinging metaphors, but I feel like any creative who like is doing it every day, it's kind of like turns into sledding, where you wind up, whether you mean to or not, like falling into certain like the same grooves, just because that's where your head goes. Like you'll gravitate towards certain lyrics or melodies or whatever, not even realizing that you're gravitating towards it. And so I feel like just having somebody else bring in, you know, a fresh layer of snow lets you lets you kind of figure out new stuff that is still very much you and your sensibility, but not necessarily like the same groove you've been like sledding down the
you're
whole
just
time.
Like spinning straight poetic bars today, I ain't just nonstop.
You know, it's my 10,000 hours, man.
It's awesome.
Love a good metaphor.
But I mean you put out a two-part record, Therapy, which I, you know, imagine was a therapeutic experience. I also love that you have a song with Drew from They.
He's awesome.
Big They fans over here. I met Drew after Lido's show.
Oh, cool.
And he was just super, super nice. I appreciate anybody who at like an LA after party can just focus on you the whole time.
Yeah.
Call it like a sort of narcissistic or like an ego thing, but like in LA, it's just, you get used to like somebody, like you're talking to somebody, but they're looking over your shoulder at like who else is more important in the room. And you did not break eye contact. It was, it was really, I don't know him very well, but that one interaction like really resonated.
And
with
it's little things like that in LA that mean a lot.
Yeah, for sure.
Coming to shows.
Yeah.
You know?
It's not like, I know how it is. Yeah. But so they were just kind of like, it wasn't a mixtape, but it was basically just like same idea in that like I didn't want to do an album, I just wanted to put out stuff. So yeah, and that was a collection. That was all the stuff I did in LA. So it was a collection of like almost every song was like different producer, or like I produced some. So there's not really like a lot of coherency between them, but it's kind of just the.
But I mean, they're tied together by you, your sensibility, which I think, you know, your voice is so distinctive that like that's why it works both as like a feature situation, but also in, you know, a mixtape. Yeah. Place of like different genres stuff, like you're the genre and then right. The rest is like detail. And
more than anything, I just wanted to experiment with like the concept of just being looser with how it, like being more ready to let go of things.
How did you and Drew come together?
We knew each other through They, like, because I listened to They and they listened to Vancouver Sleep Clinic, so we kind of connected through that a while before. Oh, cool. And then I was in LA and then I had a session on with these guys and I think we just hit him up and like, do you want to come through? And yeah, and we did that song in like a few hours, which is like the quickest I've ever done anything.
Wow.
I'm like usually quite meticulous, but that was just one.
That's a Nashville session.
Yeah. That was one of those moments, you know, those moments where you just get on a wave and you're all kind of like riding the energy and it's just like very natural. Things come together and it doesn't happen a lot in sessions, but that it did that time.
It's special when it does. Again, yeah. It's that kind of like high that you chase. That. I remember when the song came out too, I think I messaged you because I had, my family like lives in Beverly Hills and usually I anticipate traffic and inexplicably there wasn't any. And so I had an hour to kill around, like just driving around, like right, driving down Robertson and around that. I remember hearing the song because it came out as the single first. Yeah. Yeah. I remember hearing the song. And then just, I'm like, fuck, I got to hear it again. And so I just, I replayed it and it ended. I'm like, fuck, I got to hear it again. And I replayed it. And next thing I knew, like the hour had passed. I think I listened to it like 10 times. I'm like, I'm going to just message him and be like, good song, dude. Whereas like, I just listened to it like an hour's worth of the same song.
That's awesome.
But I love when a song can do that though. You know, like that's how you know.
Me too.
You did put out a record last year though. Yeah. Onward to Zion.
Yeah. So that was a bit of a different. All my projects have just been completely different places in my life.
There's definitely a Sigaros vibe to that record, which I really like.
Yeah, it's a lot. So that's the first record I've just done completely like myself. Like I had my friends come in and play some stuff, play instruments, but I like wrote and produced it all. And it was kind of like it was almost like because the therapy stuff, like I said, was every song was basically with a different producer, and it was all kind of out of that LA like. Speed dating session type thing. And I went,
so this is like the opposite side.
I
of
went
that.
So hard the other way. I was like, man, I'm so over it. Screw everyone. I went to Bali in Indonesia with like six of my high school friends. And we got like a massive house there because it's so cheap. Mm. And we stayed there for 2 months and we made that album. It was like, literally like, it's just so funny. Like, how my mind like it's just so drastic. Like in hindsight, I was like, man, I can't believe I went from like being in like the most like happening part of the. I didn't even have a phone out in Bali. Like I just went completely rogue. Like we didn't.
Oh damn.
Like none of us had phones. Like we're in the top of this massive mountain. Like no contact with anyone. No one spoke English. We like had our synths out there. So it's like it was a special thing. And it was more kind of just a healing thing, I think, for me. The album. It was for me. That's the best way of putting it. Like I didn't really think about making singles or making songs for anyone, or it was just like to kind of compensate and sort of just find that foundation again, you know. Like I needed to find why I was doing it. I think
maybe the next record's kind of like Goldilocks. Like you swung so hard on One Direction for therapy, swing so hard in the other direction for Onward Design. And then, you know, a blend of 100% you and a blend of people on like whatever.
That's exactly, yeah, you hit the nail on the head, man. Like it's exactly like what I realized. I needed to go to both ends of the spectrum to kind of realize, okay, because I didn't really enjoy doing it all myself. Like it took such a big toll on me emotionally and like, just time wise and everything, I was just drained. And also it could, like, there's just stuff that could have been better because I can't do everything like the best, obviously, like no one can. So I'm like, I kind of realized that I was like, man, like I need to find that middle point between, you know, like completely depending on everyone and like actually just opening myself up to at least have some people on board and like, do you know what I mean? Like finding that sweet spot where I can like,
yeah. I'm not in my head because I feel like we've been kind of discovering that over the last 2 years, but specifically like with this kind of like quarantine record project, half the songs are songs we did, you know, 100% us in Boston. Yeah. And, you know, half the songs or we went, not this December, but like last December, we went to like a cabin in Big Bear, just the two of us.
Oh, sick.
And just like wrote a bunch of stuff and like started a bunch of stuff. So half the record is like 100% us. And then half the record is songs we've done with other people. And honestly, the songs we did with other people are like better songs, I feel.
Right.
The songs we did just us, I think emotionally strike
us.
They're
more personal.
They're more personal and they're more artsy, honestly.
Yeah.
That's how it goes. Hey, it's the same with me. Yeah. It's interesting.
Yeah.
It's interesting trying to find that balance.
We all have like somewhat similar sensibilities. Like I think the pop punk kids who then gravitated towards like the folkier stuff or whatever, like we all want to make like an art focused record. And I think that the pop stuff scratches like the puzzle solving itch.
Yeah.
More than it does the creative itch sometimes. Yeah.
Definitely.
Like I love cracking a puzzle, you know, yeah. I'm a crossword snob, you know, I love just like trying to find the right combination of things, but that is what writing pop music oftentimes feels
like. Yeah,
it's
more like Sudoku than
picture. Yeah, it is. It is. It is 100%.
And I think that there's a lot of art in that and I feel very creative solving. It's a creative puzzle solving system, but you know, obviously the more you know, leave kind of structure by the wayside or like certain sensibilities by the wayside, the more artistic it becomes and the more potentially alienating it becomes. So I think we've balanced each other out really well.
Yeah.
But that's also why we have our own endeavors to kind of get that out of our system, you know?
Yeah. It's a never ending like battle between being arty and then trying to sell music.
Yeah.
Well, that's the thing too, is if you go too hard in any one direction,
yeah.
You know, people are either not connecting to it or not understanding it. And so I feel like the art is what allows you to,
yeah.
to connect and the sensibility is what lets you actually understand
like,
what's happening.
If it's a hobby for you, you can do whatever you want, be as arty as you want, expressive as you want. But as soon as you make it your job, you have to like realize that you need to like understand the business side of it and the like the target market and what people want to hear. And then you need to like cross the bridge between, you know, what you want to do as an artist and then how you're going to operate as a business. It's like,
yeah. Yeah.
Which is what was really hard for me to like get my head around, you know, it's really like, cause I don't come from the business. I don't care about it, but you have to, if you're trying to make a career for yourself.
Well, I think that's where I feel the most lucky to be doing this as a duo project because yeah. Noah can focus more on the, you know, artistic side of it. And then my head's always in the business. I always said that I feel like most creative thinking about like, you know, who can come together for a certain project or like, who can we hit up like at this moment or that time.
Yeah.
For you know, to sort of move this thing forward. Sometimes I get a bit too much in there, which I think like I've been getting a lot better at in the last 2 years and really starting to enjoy like the art of songwriting.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think being able to just like be like, hey, Noah, you go off into the woods, either literally or metaphorically. I'm going to check all of my emails and then we're going to come together and see if the song makes sense.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Yeah. That's awesome.
Now, what I love too is you have done like also feature stuff. The OTR song bumps.
Oh, sick. Thanks, bro.
And the Shallow song just came out as well, yeah. Which is just like absolutely, you know, silhouettes. It's just, it's awesome. And it's cool to hear, especially because in my head, I kind of put you guys in a similar space. Likewise, we were talking about Kurt, talking about Yost
yeah.
as well. Like I sort of see you guys as like, because I think Yost and Shallow share a manager. So, you know, like
oh, okay.
just seeing you guys as this kind of like family in a kind of space. It's cool to see it all come together. How did the OTR song happen? And also what was it like, you know, creating the song with Shallow?
So they both happened. They actually happened like the day after each other. And
Oh, wow.
It was on my last trip to LA, which I went there for a video. And then like I did 2 days in Shangri-La. They had, I think it was Astralworks, had like a camp there. So I went to that for 2 days and I didn't even actually have a session with OTR, but we kind of just got along because we were both like similar age and like we kind of clicked like hanging out. And then we both had nothing on that night and we found a spare studio and we made that song in a couple hours. And then he kind of put it together like afterwards on his own. So that kind of happened, which is sick. Just like real natural.
I love in camps when like the people just wind up having the offshoot because those songs wind up having like a kind of unique flavor to them.
Yeah, I think it was cool. I mean, we got, that's the interesting thing about it. I didn't really get anything good out of the rest of it, but that just happened. Like it was just effortless. It was like unplanned. It just happened. And then the next day I had an afternoon booked with Shalou, just like a different thing in LA. I think he already had the track. He had the track done already. So he was just chasing vocal on it. So yeah.
Had he written parts of the song yet, or did you guys write that together?
He had written like the instrumental and I just wrote the vocal, like the top line and the lyrics.
Were you and Shalou put together by the label, or had you guys met prior?
We'd been talking a little bit online, like we've been trying to like link up for a bit, but I'm not like great with internet collab. Like I don't really like it. I'm not really as inspired over the internet. I just like being in the room. Mm-hmm. So it's like, bro, like, let's just wait until I'm out there again and then we'll just get in together. So that's kind of what happened. And then, So I think he'd already had pretty much the album done. I would have probably been one of the last things to do that.
It's a wild record. I mean, Ash has, I love the song he did with Ash on it. I think our buddy, Peter Fenn worked on it too.
Yeah. He's awesome. And Shalou is great.
Yeah.
Yeah. We're fans. We don't know him personally, but obviously Kurt is a really good friend and they've toured together, worked together. Yeah, toured together. Mm. Yeah, I love that you know Kurt. Like
Kurt's from Brisbane.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Yeah. We know each other from high school.
Wait, that's wild. Are you guys the same age?
I think he might be older, maybe a little bit, a year or two older, maybe. But yeah, we know each other from a while ago.
How old are you?
23.
Oh, okay. I just always assumed you're older than me, but I was doing the timeline in my head of like when you were putting out the songs. I'm like, I guess, because I'm 24. I just turned 24.
You guys were 24?
He's 23, I'm 24.
Well, you can grow a way bigger beard than I can, bro. So there you go.
This is my quarantine beard. So that's
Yeah, dude. I was like, I'm doing the same thing. It doesn't grow as fast, but I'm like, man, this is the perfect time to like do facial hair that I should never be doing.
No, I got, you know, I'm like, I'm going to commit to this. I got like the beard oil and everything. I'm like,
yeah, nice,
I'm
going to
do this.
You're going to do the full grooming.
Yeah. You know, but here's the thing. I'm Jewish. So it's like a birthright thing. You know, like we all have the gene to like,
do you get birthright? Like what's the trip to Israel called?
It's called birthright. Yeah. It's actually, that was another thing that got canceled along with all of this in Corona.
Is it, you have to do it before you turn 25, right? Is that how it works?
I think it's maybe to 30. I don't know. But I imagine if anybody was before the cutoff, they'll just like extend it to anybody who was supposed to be going. Yeah. But yeah, I'm bummed I was supposed to go in May.
So your parents Jewish?
Yep. Both of them.
Yeah.
More like Mark Maron culturally.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, small world. And I just imagine also like the scene in Australia, you know, because of Triple J, like everybody's sort of aware of each other, right?
Yeah, definitely. It's sort of tight. It's tight out here.
I went to a Shabbat dinner with Wafia. You know, I've met some of the.
Yeah, she lives down the road from me.
Really?
That's how tight. Yeah, she's like one of my good friends.
That's awesome. Yeah, I don't know her super well, but I was working on a different radio show, and he did an interview with her, and she's incredibly talented.
Yeah, she's awesome.
All you Australians are something in the water, honestly. Are you ready for the question round?
Yeah.
So before we start the question round, we got a question from Finn, whose Instagram is False Fox Art. She's the one who does all of the art for the Talking Lion guests.
Yeah.
But she's asked, how did you settle on the images that go with your songs? Because they seem like there's a lot of meaning folded into them. That's her question.
Even before I start working the music, sometimes I like just trying to think about what I want to write about, what kind of picture I want to paint, like what kind of world I want it to be in aesthetically. I like kind of just, it helps me a lot to write the songs when I can understand like everything that's happening. So yeah, generally the art's always like, always a big part of the music. And it's just about putting that whole idea together. So I like having that emotional connection between the song and the art.
I feel like we sort of like establish some like rules in our head for like our art. One of them being like we try not to like feature ourselves in it. But I know sometimes you do or you have.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Do you have a kind of rationale for like when you like are style. In the cover versus something else?
Not really. I'm like, it kind of just depends on each project. Just kind of what I feel like fits where I'm at, like what stage of life I'm at. Like there's been some points where I've like wanted to be completely anonymous. Like the revival stuff, I was like, I don't want my face anywhere. Like I just want the art to kind of speak. And then like therapy stuff, I was like, put my face everywhere. Like I want there to be a face to the music. You know what I mean? Like, so
yeah.
There's just different, there's different points. And like Zion, it was like similar to Revival. I was kind of like, man.
Was Zion inspired by Sigaros visually?
No, I wouldn't say. Like, I mean, everything like on a deep level is inspired by Sigaros for me. Just as an inspiration, like subconsciously, I'm sure. But like, I wasn't specifically like, okay. No, we found this for Zion. We just found this guy called Kensuke on Instagram, actually, and I just really liked his style. He actually like chops up like vintage photos and like,
oh wow,
he like physically like manipulates them, so it's not even digital. He prints them out and like spends ages like, I don't even know how he does it, man. He like, but all of the photos are like these old postcards and stuff he's found that he's like warped and like real and then put back together again. I just thought it was really cool. But yeah, it just depends like project to project. Like I'll just kind of like get a feel for where the music's headed and what kind of like, you know, should it be photos? Should it be drawing? Should it be graphic design? Should it be painting? Like whatever. You know what I mean? Right. Like you kind of get a feel for the aesthetic as it's kind of developing. And you're like, okay.
We have, you know, at this point rules, like a sort of, you know, yeah. I could genuinely write it. Like it's a lot of, it's like a feel thing, but I could genuinely like write it down and codify it at this point just of what,
yeah.
You know, what works, like what would work for cover art and what isn't, which is tripping us up now that we can't, you know, go outside or call people or, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a lot harder to get abstract photo shoots together when you can't leave the house.
That's true.
Mm-hmm. I should have asked, you know, back when we were talking about Birthright, but you know, the song has the record has Zion in the title.
Yeah.
Have you been to Israel?
I haven't. No, it's a dream of mine though. I just can't go for free. That would be nice.
Hey, you could always convert. they would love that.
Just convert like right before I turn 25. Like, okay, guys, yeah. That's how it works, right? I get a free trip now.
All right, but yeah, are you ready for the question round for real now?
Let's do it.
All right. First question. What is your phone background?
It is a picture of me covered in trees.
Nice.
You can't even see me. It's mostly trees.
That's good. That's the way it should be. Gotta love trees. Would you have a non-musical hobby?
Sport. Specifically, soccer.
Do you still play cricket?
No, I don't, but I like watching it.
That's fun. It
just takes up too much time. It's like the game lasts for 5 days.
Cricket games can go long.
It's like baseball on steroids.
Yeah.
Are you playing soccer then?
Yeah, I was until I did my ACL like a year and a bit ago. 2 years ago now.
Oh, damn.
So I haven't really got back into it since then, but I love it. Yeah, I will get back into it. Play soccer and basketball mostly.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
What's a skill that you would like to have?
I would like to be like real tight, like graphic design.
That's a fun one.
I think it'd be cool to be able to be self-contained and do all your own art.
Yeah, that's where I'm trying to get to now, because I've done a little bit of graphic design throughout my life, and I'm trying to get like real chops with it so that I can like rely on myself.
That's awesome,
to do
man.
Art for projects. I just like DIY stuff.
It's awesome. If you can be self-contained, like it's so good. You don't have to trust anyone to do anything. You can just do it yourself as quickly as
saves you some cash too.
Because there's nothing. There's also, speaking as a person who gets paid to like make someone's aesthetic dreams come true, like I know how hard it can be on both ends of the equation. And there's nothing worse than paying a graphic designer a bunch of money to do something that's like really perfect in your head, but they don't have the resources to execute it to its full completion. And then you pay them a bunch of money, they don't give you what you want. And then it's just like,
going back and forth on like very nuanced revisions. Yeah. Like, because
That's what gets me is like when you have to do 7 or 8 revisions and you're like, man, I could do this all in one night. But it takes 2 weeks because you're going back and forth, like, man.
And as a producer, I totally understand that, like, people are always asking me to do stuff. And, like, as a producer, I understand, like, hey, my time is valuable and, like, it's not infinite. Like, I can't, for, like, $500, I'm not going to be able to make this perfect thing that you hear in your head. So when I ask that of a graphic designer, I know they're not going to give me the perfect thing that I see in my head. So I'm just like, I'm just going to learn to do it myself because...
That's awesome, it's an exercise in compromise. I'm also, when it comes to ideas, I'm a big trial and error person. Like, I like to sort of see an idea fleshed out to be able to decide if it's shit. Because in my head, every idea is kind of perfect, you know, because I get excited about it, but then it might just not work. You know, even if it's perfectly translated, it just might not work. And, you know, I've been really grateful, obviously, with Noah to be able to, you know, we figure out a song, we tried this weird experimental thing. Oh, it's too artsy, it doesn't make sense. We scrap it. But you hit up a graphic designer for like a cover art idea, and that's like a $500 art experiment.
Yeah.
You know?
No, I'm with you, man.
Feel that. All right. Very important question.
Yeah. Super important question.
Would you be a pirate?
Would I be a pirate?
Hi. Lady. Ooh,
what kind of pirate? Like ocean or internet?
Nobody's ever asked that.
I mean, I think the question pertains to, like, would you be on a boat?
Old-timey pirate.
Old-timey swashbuckling, stealing from people.
No, I wouldn't. I'm not, like, I'm not morally opposed. I mean, actually, I am kind of morally opposed to it, but also I just don't like boats that much.
Yeah, that's fair.
It's been a very divisive question. It's survived.
It's the most contentious
question. I think the idea of it is nice, like, from what we see in the movies, but actually, like, the things you would have to do as a pirate would be pretty horrible.
this is my position. I'm glad you're on my side. this is the reason I like this question, because I feel like it gets at something very interesting about, like, what people think of as pirates and then trying to imagine the actual physical reality of what that would entail
and how people feel about boats.
Very important.
We now know all of our guests' opinions of
it's
boats.
That's true.
It's super, glorified. It's super glorified.
Yeah, it is one of those things that's very glorified.
I'd do that's it. What I think I love being a pirate.
Would you, though? Yeah, you would.
Yeah.
Yeah, you've already got the beard happening, man. You're good to go.
Yeah, exactly.
I.
Do you have any tattoos? And if so, what was your first?
Yeah, I have a few. My first one is on my arm, and it says, "This life is not my own," which is the lyric from my favorite hymn. Mm. It's the best one to get first because it kind of, like, is my parents and it's the idea of me getting it, because, like, oh, mom, it's Christian, like, can't be mad.
Yeah, that's funny.
Yeah,
what was the first concert you ever attended?
Ooh, that's tough. Switchfoot. I think it was Switchfoot.
Ooh, that's a good one.
Ooh.
Switchfoot was my first.
I loved Switchfoot.
First favorite band.
I got some good stuff.
I was a big Only Hope fan as a kid.
Yeah
That's a beautiful song.
I love it, man. I love it.
Really good song.
Yeah, it wouldn't switch, but I would have probably been like probably 8 or 9. Probably went with my dad or something.
What is your go-to karaoke song?
"Love the Way You Lie" by Rihanna and Eminem.
Oh,
yeah.
Do you do the Rihanna bit I know the Eminem bit?
For sure.
That's fantastic. Do you have a scar with a story?
A scar? Yeah. So I have one on my knee from a few months ago. I actually fell over on stage. We were playing "Collapse."
You collapsed playing "Collapse." Right,
it's like, sorry, damn. Like, the timing is ridiculous. I put it on my Instagram a while ago, and I was like, literally,
it was like "Donna, no,
bro." I was literally singing the words like "Falling Short Again," and I like went to step on a fallback wedge, and like I wasn't really like paying attention. It was pretty loose, and I stepped on it. And my head hit the ceiling. I was like, "I'm falling short again." I sung it, and then head hit the ceiling. Like, I got disorientated. Like, wobbled on the fallback, and the fallback wedge gave away, and I face planted in the stage.
Oh.
But I couldn't really feel anything at the time. I just kind of kept going on with it. And then I, like,
adrenaline's a hell of a drug.
Adrenaline, bro. Yeah. And then an hour after the show, I checked my leg. There's just blood everywhere. Have a scar there from that.
Damn. Jeez. That's brutal. That's battle scars. That's
the hazards
of the job. Next question is, what are three thoughts you have at this very moment?
What am I going to eat for dinner?
Nice.
How long until I can leave my house?
Yeah. Big vibe.
And which team am I going to play with on FIFA next.
I like it.
Profound.
Those are good thoughts.
Good thoughts.
Important thoughts.
It's funny. I feel like whenever we ask the three thought question, one of them is always devoted to food.
Yeah, I think it's just like a basic human drive. Yeah. It's people are always just like food.
I mean, especially now, like it's just everything you do is just in between meals.
Yeah, that's very true.
Yeah, definitely.
More now than ever.
I mean, if you were to ask me, I'd be like, yeah, what are we doing for dinner? Like, I'm really hungry.
We made pasta. We have leftover pasta. We don't have to worry about
it. Do they have delivery food going strong there right now?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, they do.
And they're pushing for like, they're giving like free delivery for local businesses too. So nice. They can stay afloat.
Next question is, what are you most proud of?
I'm most proud of pushing myself to get this far with my music and career, I guess. Like pushing through everything and staying strong and like to what I believe in, I think.
Yeah.
I think... to that, you know, the fact that you've held to your integrity and like the fact that you've always come at this with like a very strong level of authenticity and has been really inspiring to us. And I'm sure we're not the only ones. Like, obviously, awesome. you were there when we've like sonically when we first started, but just being able to watch someone we respected never kind of compromise their sound or their like, you know, ideals has been really
appreciate that, bro.
Us.
Yeah, appreciate that.
Well, and I'm sure there are people listening who feel the same way, like artists listening who, you know, you were doing something before other people were, and I feel like there are plenty of bands that were like us that started listening to your stuff. So,
yeah,
appreciate that.
And on that note, what's important to you? What's something that's important to you?
My faith. And yeah, just being true to myself.
Appreciate
like
that.
Being transparent. I think being transparent and like connect, like accessible, I think is important to me at least.
I think that's how we got along like after the show is like, you know, you like we had definitely opened for people in Boston who kind of just like because they were headliners, like acted like headliners and just like didn't necessarily, you know, open up to us in the same way that like you did. And it was really nice just like how
I still have your USB from that show.
That's
awesome.
Iconic. I'm going to sell out for a lot of money one day. Just going to make completely like...
That record's 5 years old now. It's right, getting vintage.
Yeah. We'll scour eBay and see when it goes out.
Like 200 years in the future when there's like no USB ports. Like that thing will be...
Yeah,
like,
it's going to be like that'll floppy be worth disks a lot of money. Or something.
We were like... my friend about the USBs the other day, and I feel like we were early to some stuff, like the USBs and QR codes, to the point where it made no sense when we were putting it out. And then like once we stopped playing shows is when people started like using USBs. Now we go back, nobody's got USB, you know, drives.
When we go back to
doing shows, nobody will have USB
drives.
Oh yeah,
that's true. Now it doesn't make any sense because somebody like, I don't have a USB. I mean, I guess I do. I mean, we all have ways of plugging in USB 3.0.
But also, I mean, streaming is just like, nobody's gonna listen to our record like by opening up a USB.
Stores music.
I miss that though. I miss roaming around the internet, like looking for free downloads and like, kind of collecting your own like digital like portfolio,
giving your computer a virus just to get like
the Britney Spears single,
the live recording of System of a Down.
Exactly.
So true. Yeah, YouTube to MP3, like
YouTube to MP3, a lifesaver.
I was reading in the, like a music business kind of like kind of history of music business book that the actual thing that caused iTunes to be as successful as it was this frustration with the Napster, like LimeWire user base of having to like get all the metadata and all the cover art right.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
I used to spend hours, like with all my torrented albums, I would go and like, there was a third party software that would look for the album art, but then it wouldn't always work. And then I would spend all this time hunting down album art and trying to find the highest quality like image.
It's so funny.
Like, and now I'm just gonna, you know what grinds my gears about Spotify?
Tell us, Dad.
The album art's tiny. Like it doesn't make any sense that like even on the web desktop player for Spotify, like the album art is still super small and you can't make it big. And I guess like on your phone you can see it, but now everything's canvas anyway. So it's like like, that's the thing. You pay a graphic designer a grand to like design your album art, and people, it's only like tiny. Like, no one's going to look at it in like a large format because it's just not going to exist.
It's good on the phone, but yeah, on the
It's like, that's the thing. It seems like it's designed for mobile.
I'll speculate and I'll posit that maybe nowadays cover art is less for the actual music and more for the Instagram post around the release.
Yeah, pretty much.
That's kind of what I was like. I think I was kind of touching on that before. It's just like not as much about the whole thing anymore. It doesn't really matter what art you put up. Yeah, it's about it's about your social media, your posting, all that stuff. Like, it's just changed so much.
And the last question of the Talking Lion Quest round is, what are you looking forward to?
I mean, like everyone, I guess, just looking forward to getting outside again, playing shows again, making music again, like getting back into it. It's like, it's one of those things, like it just makes you grateful for things you weren't grateful for, which is, it's a nice little like refresher, being like all the things you take for granted, like just being out of like,
I think when this started out, like I was just getting to the point of being like annoyed with like parties and shows and like all that stuff. And now, you know, you don't know what you got till it's gone.
Yeah. And I think we're going to see a really big spike in like artistic, like energy and like in this kind of like reinvigorated like sense of spirit in the community after this. I think everyone's going to, it's going to be hopefully like a real like flurry of like cool stuff and cool energy going around.
The Corona Renaissance.
Yeah. This happened. Yeah. Someone was saying, I can't remember what it was. My memory's terrible, but it was in like the 20s. So it was like a plague or something. That was
the Spanish influenza.
Yeah. Is that what it was? Yeah. There was a big like renaissance of like.
Well, I remember seeing when this first started, you know, like that, you know, Shakespeare did King Lear in quarantine and stuff. And there's definitely something to be said. You know, I mean, I feel like everybody who's creative, even if they're not feeling inspired, like right now, we are going to be alone and not like alone, but we're going to be in this thing for so long that you're inevitably going to wind up doing something like just to get through it, you know?
Yeah.
So I'm with you. I'm excited to see what that winds up being, you know, and I'm excited to see what you wind up doing with it as well.
Yeah, we'll see.
And you know, when you start playing live again, when you're back in Los Angeles, we'll do karaoke. And we'll see you. Done. See you play live. Done. You know?
Sounds good, man.
No, it's great catching up with you, man. I feel like it's been one of the brighter sides of the quarantine is just being able to catch up with old friends.
Yeah, it's been a while, man. Appreciate you guys.
And thank you again just for being such an awesome guy throughout like our whole music life.
Yeah, appreciate you guys. Stay safe. Stay in touch. Talk to you guys soon. The end of the day, we're helpless. Can you keep me close? Can you love me most? Can you keep me close? Can you love me most? Can you keep me close? Can you love me?
We would like to thank Alan C. for supporting Talking Lion on Patreon and Isotope.